Good morning all. Today we are going to discuss about the slot harmonics. So these harmonics are also called as tooth harmonics or tooth ripples, or they are also called as slot ripples. Let us see why they come. So if you take the ideal case, so ideally we assume that whatever is the stator, if I am taking my one pole pitch is the distance between two adjacent poles. So let us take, this is my stator and there will be some air gap. This is my rotor. And this is my air gap. So ideally we assume that the air gap is uniform between the stator and rotor, or we assume that the stator and rotor are smooth. Let us assume if I make the winding in such a way, I get a sinusoidal MMF distribution. Let us assume this is my MMF that is produced by my stator. So this is my stator MMF. So because of this MMF, MMF divided by reluctance will give you your flux. Flux is equal to MMF divided by reluctance. Because air gap is uniform, so reluctance will be uniform. MMF is sinusoidal, so automatically your flux will be sinusoidal. So we take that your flux is sinusoidal, or we can tell this flux density that is produced will be sinusoidal. This is air gap, flux density. This is flux per unit area. That is sinusoidal. So if you are giving sinusoidal EMF, sinusoidal flux is produced. So sinusoidal EMF will be induced in both stator and rotor. So this is what we assume. But practically, the rotor will not be smooth, as well as the stator also will not be smooth. Let us assume the one case that stator is smooth and the rotor is not smooth. So in that case, what is going to happen? And the same thing can be extended for the case of both the stator and rotor slotings. So like this, the rotor is slotted. So when the rotor is slotted, you can see here at this point the gap is more, and at this point the gap is less. Again at this point the gap is more, at this point the gap is less. So otherwise we can tell that at this point the reluctance is more and at this point the reluctance is less. So we know for a given MMF, MMF by reluctance, as the reluctance is more here, the flux will be less here, and in the second case the flux will be more. So we can tell that whenever, because of non-uniform distribution of the flux, non-uniform distribution of the gap, so automatically non-uniform distribution of the flux comes, or your primary flux will get distorted. So this is the main reason for the production of slot harmonics, or otherwise we can tell the slot harmonics are produced mainly because of the slotting for keeping the winding either in the stator or in the rotor. So when this will be more dominating? So it is observed that it will be more dominating when the width of your slot opening is far greater than compared to your tooth width and air gap length. So when compared to the air gap length and tooth width, if your width of the slotter openings, because this is my width of slot opening, I have made a dip here for the rotor. So this is my teeth. So when compared to teeth width, if this width is more, then in that case your harmonics will be more dominating. So this will be the practical case for any type of machine you take. That's why always slot harmonics will be there in every machine. Let us see how the slot harmonic comes and how to analyze it further. So that we are going to see now. So let us assume this is my stator. This is my stator. So I am taking this as one pole pitch. So one pole pitch for the case of stator. Pole pitch is the distance between two adjacent poles. Remember this. So this one I am dividing into different type of slottings. So let us assume I am dividing here. So this much is the slotting. So like this I have made the slotting. So now let us try to see what will be the effect of this slotting. For that, I am just drawing the lines, extending the lines. So this is my air gap and this is my rotor. So let us assume my stator is producing a sinusoidal MMF wave. So when the stator is producing the sinusoidal MMF wave, so that I am representing here, the MMF wave distribution by the stator will be sinusoidal. That means it will vary between these two. So So let us assume it is varying like this. This is my stator MMF wave, it becomes 0 here. So this is my MMF wave of produced by the stator. Stator MMF wave. Now because of the stator MMF wave, so the rotor, that air gap flux will be produced. So the air gap flux we are going to draw now. So again I am extending the line. So try to follow this so that it will be more clear to you. You will understand the concept clearly. So we know that the flux is equal to MMF divided by reluctance. So ideally the value of MMF by reluctance should follow the same curve. So ideally the curve should come like this. Ideally the curve should come like this. But practically you can see here, here the air gap is less and here the air gap is more. So when air gap is more, automatically reluctance will be more. Or we can tell that wherever air gap is more, then the MMF by reluctance will become less. So that's why I can get my air gap flux density wave will come like this. Here the reluctance is less. So as the reluctance is less, MMF by reluctance, so that will become positive. So that's why this will be positive. And here MMF by reluctance will be negative. Again it will be positive. So it is more and here it will be less. And here it is more and here it will be less. Here it is more and here it will be less. So you can see this is my resultant value, resultant air gap flux. Why this came? This is because of non-uniform air gap between the stator and the rotor, and this happens because of slot openings. I am explaining this once again because we know the flux is equal to MMF divided by reluctance. So what you have to do, you have to take the MMF at that particular point divided by reluctance at that particular point. So if you take at this particular point, you can see the gap is less. As the gap is less, MMF by reluctance will be more. That's why your curve has gone up. So it is more. And coming to this part, so at this stage, MMF by reluctance, the reluctance is more, so automatically that's why there is a dip. So similarly, there is up and down. And you have to remember here, wherever the MMF is more, MMF by reluctance will be much more dominant. Or we can tell that the wave will have more magnitude in this region compared to the remaining region. Why? The value of MMF is more, because this is MMF divided by reluctance. That I was not able to represent properly here. I hope you can understand this. So this one I can resolve into two components. One component will be your fundamental component. So this I am resolving into the fundamental component. This is my fundamental component. And the second one, I am representing this disturbance. This is caused due to this one. So this disturbance that is caused due to this one is depending on the value of the MMF at that point, or it will follow the same MMF type of envelope. So, and you can draw the value. So here it is coming as positive. So I am just extending the lines. So let us try to draw this. So here it is positive, so here it is coming negative, positive, negative, positive, negative, positive and negative. So in this way, this is my, the value of slot harmonics. So why this magnitude is coming? This magnitude is coming because of MMF divided by reluctance, because of non-uniform that one. So that's why there are fluctuations. So that I have represented here. So this is with respect to my angle theta. So let us try to number these diagrams so that it will be easy to analyze. So I am making the numbering of these things. This is A, B, C, D and E. So now from this you can observe that what are the number of slots that are happening in this. So number of slots are 1, 2, 3, 4. There are 4 slots. So you can see how many half cycles are completing. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So when there are 4 slots per pole pitch, so you are getting total 8 half cycles. Or we can tell in one half cycle of your original MMF wave, you are getting 8 half cycles. So you are getting 8 times. Or we can tell that in one full cycle of MMF wave, you will get 8 full cycles of your harmonic frequency. So 8 full cycles of your harmonic frequency. Here 8 half cycles are coming. To get 8 full cycles, we have to go through 2 pair of poles. That means you have to go through a pair of poles. So otherwise we can tell that this FS, the frequency of the slot harmonics, will be your fundamental frequency, because one full cycle will complete with 2 pair of poles. That means 2 pair of poles, how many slots will be there? Total number of slots, let us assume in your machine, is S divided by pair of poles. So that gives number of slots in one pair of pole. Again, I am revising here. You can see here the slots are 1, 2, 3, 4. 4 slots are there in one pole pitch. We have to take 2 pole pitch. Then the pair of poles will come. One full cycle will complete. So you will see here it will become 2 times the 4 or 8. Or it is nothing but the number of slots that are there in one pair of poles. So that is the reason I have written this. This is what we got. So now I want to represent my harmonic frequency wave. So how can I represent my harmonic frequency wave? You can see here harmonic frequency wave is having two components. One is the harmonic frequency. It is rotating at the frequency of the harmonic frequency or the slot harmonic frequency within the envelope of your main frequency. Because that maximum value is not constant, it is varying within the envelope of your fundamental frequency. So that's why I am trying to write the equation for this. So I am writing the equation for this resultant air gap flux wave. So the resultant air gap flux wave I can write as, let us assume phi is my resultant air gap flux wave. So this I can write as the flux phi is equal to some phi 1 cos omega t, phi 1 cos omega t, this is because of the fundamental one. This fundamental one is represented here. Now this slot harmonic component I have to represent. Let us assume that slot harmonics have maximum flux of phi s into sin omega st, because it is varying sinusoidal, into cos omega t. Let us see why I have written this. So let us take, for example, I am taking the fundamental component from this reference. That means this will be my reference point. From this I want to represent. So I can represent my fundamental as the cosine wave. So you can see here this is coming as the cosine wave. That's why I have represented as phi 1 cos omega t. Now coming to this envelope, you can see this envelope. This envelope is having the fundamental cosine wave. So that's why I have written this cos omega t. That means it is following the fundamental cosine wave envelope. Multiplied by, you have to multiply this with how it is varying. You can see here this is following a sinusoidal waveform. So it is following the sinusoidal wave. So that's why I have written here sin omega st, where omega s is the frequency of your harmonics. The omega s is, this is 2 pi into fs. So fs is the frequency of your slot harmonics. And omega is your fundamental frequency. That means 2 pi your fundamental frequency. I hope this is clear. It is having two components. I am explaining again. One component is your fundamental component. The second component is harmonic component. The harmonic component is not constant, but it is varying with respect to the envelope of your fundamental frequency. So to represent that, I have kept the term cos omega t, and sin omega st represent your wave. So I am taking the reference from the maximum value of the fundamental. You can see here you are getting a sinusoidal wave. I hope this is clear. So let us proceed further. So now let us see how to calculate the EMF generated in an N turn coil because of the effect of these harmonics. So we know that the EMF generated in one N turn coil is given by E is equal to minus N into d phi by dt. Minus n into d phi by dt, or this I can write as minus n into d by dt of, I am just substituting the equation we have written. So we got it as phi 1 cos omega t plus phi s sin omega st into cos omega t. So this I can rewrite as minus n into d by dt of phi 1 cos omega t plus this phi s by 2, because we know that 2 sin a cos b will become sin a plus b plus sin a minus b. So I want to convert in that form. So that's why I have written phi s by 2. I have multiplied 2 here. That means I have divided and multiplied with 2. So this one I can write as sin of omega s plus omega times of t plus sin of omega s minus omega times of sin a plus b plus sin a minus b. This becomes 2 sin a cos b. Done. So this now I am substituting. So when you are applying this, this becomes n into omega into phi 1 into sin omega t, because d by dt of cos omega t is minus sin omega t. So minus n into phi s by 2, this becomes omega s plus omega into cos of omega s plus omega into t, and second term is omega s minus omega into cos of omega s minus omega into t. So you can see here you are getting two terms. This is my first term, this is my second term, and this is my third term. So let us try to separate these terms so that it will be more clear. It is having total three components. So this I can write as n times of omega phi 1 into sin omega t minus n times of phi s by 2 into omega s plus omega into cos of omega s plus omega into t, and the third from minus phi n times of phi s by 2 omega s minus omega into cos of omega s minus omega into t. So you can see here, let us take this as equation number 1. So if you observe this equation, it is having three components. One is, you can see here, this sinusoidal function, it is having the fundamental frequency f, and the disk term is rotating at a frequency of omega s plus omega, or we can tell this as having f s plus f. It is at that frequency it is oscillating. So similarly, this is oscillating at omega s minus omega. So total three frequencies are there. So let us try to write this. What does it mean? So omega s plus omega is the speed at which this rotates, the second wave rotates. So this I can write as 2 pi f s plus 2 pi f, or this I can write as 2 pi f into, so we know the value of fs. Fs we have just derived, the value is equal to fundamental frequency into s divided by p by 2. So this I can write as 2s by p. So I have just substituted the value of fs which we have just previously derived, 2s by p plus 1. So this is clear. So the second one, omega s minus omega, I can write as 2 pi fs minus 2 pi f. This becomes 2 pi f into 2s by p minus 1. That means we can conclude that the slot harmonics are having a frequency of omega, and the frequency will be, the slot harmonic frequency will be 2s by p plus or minus 1. One is having the plus sign, another hand is having minus sign, times of f times of h. So this is the frequency of your slot harmonics. There are two types of harmonics. One is coming with plus sign, another one is coming with minus sign. Or this 2s by p I can represent as 2 times of slots per pole. Slots per pole means, let us assume there are m phase winding. So I can write this as 2 times of m into q, where m is the number of phases and q is the slots per pole per phase. So s by p is slots per pole. Slots per pole is nothing but number of phases multiplied by slots per pole per phase. I can either write that, or I can write this as 2 times of q, where q is nothing but the slots per pole, because so that the analysis will be easy. So that's why I can represent as 2 times of mq or 2 times of q. Generally, if you take a 3 phase machine, we know the value of m is equal to 3. So I can substitute this value. So I can write my 2s by p will be equal to 6 times of q. 2s by p will be equal to 6 times of q, or 2 times of capital Q. So therefore, I can write my slot harmonic frequency as 6q plus or minus 1 times of your fundamental frequency, or this I can write as 2q plus or minus 1 times of your fundamental frequency. So let us take for example, because while taking all the analysis, I have only taken the slotting in the rotor. But slotting will be there in stator as well, because winding will be there in stator as well as rotor. So let us take for example, my stator has S1 stator slots. If my winding has S1 stator slots, then this harmonic frequency produced because of stator slotting will be equal to 2 times of S1 by P plus or minus 1. Similarly, let us assume your rotor has S2 rotor slots. So rotor slots in your rotor is S2, then the frequency of your slotting frequency will be 2 times of S2 by P plus or minus 1. So two type of harmonics will come, one because of the stator slotting and second one because of the rotor slotting. So two type of slottings will come. So that thing you have to remember this. So I hope up to here it is clear to you. So next class we are going to see how to remove the slot harmonics and what will be the effect of removing the slot harmonics. When you remove the slot harmonics, how it is going to affect the performance of your system. That means next class we are going to see what is the skewing of the rotor slots and what will be the effect of skewing of the rotor slots on your machine performance, and we will try to solve some numerical also. If you have any query, you can leave your comments in the comment section below. I will answer to your query from there. Thank you. Thank you very much.